So I'm Dr. Trier. I am the pediatric liaison for Sacramento, and I am working with Deb to kind of enhance our pediatric training in the ED. And so every month what we're going to be doing is these pediatric mock codes based on different topics. And this month's topic is pediatric diabetic ketoacidosis. And so I'd like to start off with this little case scenario. So I have a 7-year-old male that presents to the emergency department. So this one day history of vomiting and just not feeling well. Current vitals are up there. Normal temperature, a little bit tachycardic, a little bit tachypneic, a little bit hypotensive with a blood pressure of 90 over 65. When you look at him, he is a little lethargic, but he's able to answer questions. He knows where he is. And then on further examination, you notice that he has kind of like a fruity odor to his breath. He has dry mucous membranes, but otherwise his examination is relatively normal. We can get some past medical history. No medical problems, doesn't take any medications. So let's try to get some labs. The labs that we draw are HEM7, we can get an VBG. It's not as traumatic, so that's ideal, and a urine. And so these are the labs that we see. And then you notice that he has a sodium of 147, his potassium is 3.5, chloride 112, and bicarb of 5. Creatinine is normal, BUN is elevated at 28, and the glucose of 430, and an anion gap of 30. He is anion gap metabolic acidosis, and there are many things that can cause that. In this case, it looks like it's DKA. And so it also, you can see the urine shows 4+ glucose in addition to having ketones. So there are four things that really define DKA. When you have a pH is less than 7.3, if you have a bicarb that's less than 15, and you have a glucose that's greater than 300, and also the presence of ketones. So with those four things, that identifies diabetic ketoacidosis. Okay, so some pathophysiology. This is what happens. You have insulin receptors on the cell. The insulin binds to the cell, allows glucose to go in. The insulin also penetrates the cell, gets in there, and blocks the pathway of lipogenesis. So it prevents the lipids from getting metabolized. Without that insulin, what happens is you have all the glucose on the outside of the cell. The insulin doesn't get into the cell. You have all these fatty acids that are getting in and then being oxidized into acetone, acetoacetate, and beta-hydroxybutyrate, right? Those are all ketones. That's the ketogenesis. With those production of those compounds, what happens is you have hydrogen ion produced, causing the acidosis, right? The acidosis in the cell causes the potassium to go out of the cell extracellularly. So you have a high potassium out of the cell, you have all these ketones in the cell, you have the acidosis, right? And so what happens, you also have all the glucose on the outside. The uptake of glucose within the kidneys is roughly around 180 to 200 micrograms per deciliter. And so that's the threshold. So as soon as you hit that threshold, you're going to be spilling glucose in the urine, which is causing an osmotic diuresis. So you're going to be peeing more, the potassium is going to be in the urine, right? You're going to lead to dehydration, okay? So three things. Dehydration is going on, you have potassium that's getting out of the cell, and you have the acidosis, you have the osmotic diuresis, right? All those things are playing in because of lack of insulin, okay? That's part of the physiology, and that's what we have to treat. And that's what's causing all of the symptoms, the drinking and the peeing and then not feeling well, the lethargy and the dehydration. These are questions I just want you to read. How much fluid would you administer as a bolus? How much insulin would you start to administer? And then what type of IV fluids you want to start and at what rate? So let's try with just giving fluids first. The dose to bolus children is 20 milliliters per kilogram, one-time bolus. Typically, that bolus will increase the hemodynamics. If the hemodynamics don't improve, then you do a second bolus. What we don't want to do is do an aggressive hydration in kids. So after the initial bolus, what we're going to do is we're going to start a maintenance of 1/2 normal saline. So in order to calculate the maintenance fluid for pediatrics, we use the following formula. For up to 20 kilograms, we use 4 milliliters per kilogram. From 20 to 30 kilograms, we use 2 cc's or 2 milliliters per kilogram, and after 30 kilograms, we use 1 cc per kilogram. You talk about giving insulin. One major thing you have to really consider before you ever give insulin is what the potassium is. because they're already depleted. The potassium on our Chem7 earlier, I think it was 3.5. So with 3.5, you already have all the potassium that's been shipped out of the cell. Typically, if all the potassium shipped out of the cell, you expect like a hyperglycemia, like 5 or 6. But now he's at 3.5, so he's been wasting. So if you were to give insulin now, what would happen is insulin has the effect of shifting the potassium back into the cells. He'll become hypokalemic, and he'll go into ventricular tachycardia, and he can die. That is very key for people to look out for, is the potassium. If we do have a low potassium, what we have to look at is replacement, even before we give insulin, or during we're given insulin, right? And so if it's less than 5, we give 40 milliequivalents per liter to fluids, right? And then you just put it into the maintenance. So what you want to do, the dosing is 0.1 units per kilogram per hour. We want to continue that. So our blood sugar was 430. So we're going to slowly decrease the glucose between 50 and 100 milligram per deciliter per hour. I don't care about the sugar. What I care about is the acidosis. The insulin is going to correct the acidosis. So what it's going to do, it's going to bind to the receptors, it's going to have the glucose get into the cell, and it's also going to deregulate all the counter-regulatory hormones like we talked about before, like the breakdown of lipids and gluconeogenesis. So the process just has to start ramping up again, okay? So while this is going on, the glucose is going to decrease. So if I get a glucose that's less than 250, I'm going to add sugar to my maintenance, because what I don't want to do is get into a hyperglycemic state. What I want to do is I want to correct the acidosis, and then you can monitor that by doing Chem7s every 2 to 4 hours to see if you still have the acidosis by looking at the bicarb and also the anion gap. And you generally do not want to stop insulin. Add the sugar while going through this whole process. Okay, so we're going to continue with a little case scenario. So over the last hour, your patient starts complaining of headache. He's now unresponsive. He has fixed and dilated pupils. Heart rate is 50, respiration's 8, and he's hypertensive. What's happening? You got cerebral edema. Bad, bad, bad. Why this occurs? Really don't know. Decrease the pressure, you can do one of a couple things. One, you give mannitol. It's 1 milligram per kilogram bolus. Two, you give him hypertonic saline. For the respiratory depression, you can intubate. Thank you for coming, and if you have any additional questions, please feel free to contact me.